Hello, Calvary. Mark and Johnny behind the camera coming to you again this year on behalf of the Missions Committee. And we want to talk to you a little bit about the upcoming Missions Month of October. Calvary, part of being a passionate follower of Christ is doing what he said. And one of the last things that Jesus said to his disciples on earth was to go and make disciples of all nations. And so that's something that we want to be a part of as a church. We want to be passionate about that. And that is really what drives our Missions Month of October. For those of you that are new to this or aren't really following the past few years, so we've switched it up from a conference to a month, and we take, in the past, we've taken 4 or 5 different projects, and we try to raise as much financial aid for those as we can to be able to support those ministries around the world. And as well, we'll have guest speakers each Sunday coming to the church to be able to chat with you guys about the missions that they're involved with and the different ministries that they are a part of around the world. So I want to talk to you primarily today about the ministries that we've chosen as a committee to support this year. So the first one that we are going to be supporting is through Bashara and Rula Karkofi, who are missionaries that we support regularly as a church. And they live in the Middle East, and they are doing all kinds of work. But one thing lately that has come up is that they are involved with prison ministry in 4 different countries in the Middle East. Hopefully soon in a 5th, they're going to try to start up in Turkey. And those ministries are, they're able to reach inmates of prisons that otherwise would not be able to hear the gospel, would never hear of Christ. And so we believe that that's a very, very cool ministry, very important, and we want to be able to give them funds to support that ministry. Secondly, we've chosen to partner with Jeremy and Heidi Mullins. So they are missionaries, again, that we support regularly as a church. And one of the projects that Jeremy's been working on is to be able to produce Bible stories in Arabic and Spanish for kids. And so he's looking at finishing that project up. Needs a little bit of funds to be able to finish that, as well as upgrade some of his audio equipment in his studio. So we want to be able to partner with him to be able to help him with that. Next up, we're going to be working with Galcom, which is another organization you may be familiar with. We've partnered with them in the past to be able to build radio towers in Quebec. And so now this next project, one that they're working on, is to be able to provide 10,000 solar audio devices for South Sudan. And so those are going to be able to spread the gospel to places where it would never ever be able to go. And literacy rates being what they are in Sudan, the best way is through audio equipment. And so they are working in that way, and we want to be able to support them through that. Next up, we are going to be working with Vladimir Vysotsky, who's a pastor in Russia. And he, every year, he is able to provide church camps, basically like a day camp for teens. And he's able to bring 10 teens on 5 different camps throughout the year, so 50 teens. And we're going to be able to provide the funds for him to facilitate those camps. It's an awesome way to be able to minister and disciple to youth. And we're very, very excited about that one. Lastly, as part of our 5 main projects for the main church body, we're going to be partnering with Dean O'Connor. Some of you guys may know Dave O'Connor's brother, and he is partnering with Souls for Christ. And so they're operating in Toronto, and we're going to be able to provide blankets and Bibles for homeless people in Toronto this year. Obviously, as you guys know, cost of living and the way things have been going, it's harder and harder these days for some of those people to be able to have the necessities of life. And so we're very, very excited to be able to provide both warmth and something physical this winter, as well as the Word of God. So that's a very, very, very cool project we're excited about. And lastly, as part of our children's project, we had one last year. We're going to be doing that again this year. And more information exactly to follow on how that's going to work. But the funds are going to be going towards a children's home in Honduras. So right now, this particular home houses 29 children, and all the staff and children are in one building. So we're going to be able to take those funds and direct them so that they can hopefully build a new building soon for the teens, as well as renovate the existing building. So there you have it. Those are our 6 projects this year. I hope you guys can get on board with them. I hope first and foremost that you will pray. Pray with your family. whether it's at the breakfast table, the dinner table, before you go to bed, I hope that we can all get passionate about this, not just 1 month of the year, but particularly now that we can focus on that. And as a church, come behind these ministries to further God's kingdom and to be able to share the love of Christ with people all over the world. So thank you for your support. We look forward to hearing from you guys throughout the month, and God bless you.
Well, again, that is the last time that you will see the video this year with regards to our missions projects that we are supporting. And again, if you haven't pulled the trigger and you haven't kind of transferred those funds into the church's account, again, marked for our missions project, please do so. It'd be great to have your support. I think up to date, we've raised about $11,500 so far over and above our regular tithes and offerings. And so we give thanks to God for that. And again, we look forward to more money that will come in over the next 2 or 3 weeks. It's the valley. Let's face it, we don't usually do things on time. It's usually a little bit of drift that happens, like you all kind of drifting in just as the video's playing, as the church service has started. I get it. I've been here 11 years. I understand now. But I jest. But it'll be good to have you continue to contribute towards that. And again, to allow us as a little church on the edge of Ontario to continue to have a worldwide influence and to punch above our weight. My name is Richard. If you're visiting with us this morning here at Calvary, I'm one of the pastors here. And again, I just want to perhaps encourage you to dawdle a little bit, to hang around a little bit after the first service, because Pastor Paul will be coming to the second service. And so if you hang around a little bit long enough, you might be able to crisscross over with him and again continue to assure him of your care, love, and prayers. Just by way of our call to worship this morning, I would love to read to you verses from the little book of Zephaniah. And you're looking at me going, that's a book in the Bible? I'm going to tell you, yes, it is. It's one of those little books where your pages of your Bible are still stuck together at the end of the Old Testament. Zephaniah is one of the little minor prophets. It's only got 3 chapters, and it's from the 3rd chapter that I would love to read to you from. Zephaniah 3, verse 14 says, "Sing aloud, O daughter of Zion. Shout, O Israel. Rejoice and exult with all your heart, O daughter of Jerusalem. The Lord has taken away the judgments against you. He has cleared away your enemies. The King of Israel, the Lord, is in your midst. You shall never again fear evil. On that day it shall be said to Jerusalem, 'Fear not, O Zion. Let not your hands grow weak. The Lord your God is in your midst, a mighty one who will save. He will rejoice over you with gladness. He will quiet you by his love, and he will exult over you with loud singing.'" Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we ask your hand of blessing to be upon our time together as a church family. As you rejoice over us in singing, Father, may we reflect that back to you out of hearts of joy, because we belong to you through the Lord Jesus Christ. May your Holy Spirit guide us in these moments, and we pray them in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Mainly in our church, we sing songs that would be spiritual songs. But back in July, we did sing a psalm, and that was "A Mighty Fortress Is Our God," which is Psalm 46. And Luther, who penned the words, would say to Melanchthon, "Let's sing the 46th. And they go out into the night. And at that particular time, of course, Luther was, there was a bounty on his head. But there are three passages that I can find in Scripture that talk about psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs. Today we're going to sing hymns as opposed to spiritual songs. It'll be different, especially if you're born 50 years old or younger. Quite familiar to people 50 and older. But if you just try to follow us, it might be a little bit different. But in Acts 16:25, that's when Paul and Silas were in the jail. And they, what were they doing in jail? They weren't moping. They were singing hymns to God. And the prisoners were listening. They were sort of witnessing where they were. In Ephesians, there's another one addressing one another with psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, making melody in your heart. So that's lifting each other up. That's what we like to do today. But not just to us, but to him. And then Colossians 3:16, let the word of God dwell richly, teaching and admonishing one another in all wisdom, and then singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs with thankfulness in your heart. So there's several things we can do. Today we can sing, lift each other up, lift up praise to God, and be thankful. Our first song is Alas, and Did My Savior Die? And before we just start, I just want to mention that was written by Isaac Watts, who wrote 750 hymns. Okay. Stand.
Alas, and did my Savior bleed, and did my Sovereign die? Would he devote that sacred head for such a worm as I? Was it for Christ
song. The next song is Fanny Crosby. And the interesting thing about Fanny Crosby, she was 30 years old when she heard that hymn that we just sang. She thought she was a Christian. But that day, she met the Savior because of the words of that song. That's how powerful songs are. Fanny Crosby was blind from about 6 months old throughout her total life. But she is thought of as the more modern day hymnal as opposed to Isaac Watts. And she wrote 8,000 hymns, Most of them aren't even sung anymore, even written. But she also sang, some of her songs were, "When I Survey the Wondrous Cross, Joy to the World, Our God, Our Help in Ages Past." So you've probably heard those before. But if you go through our hymn book, you'll find Isaac Watts and Fanny Crosby comes up a lot. So we'll sing and stand and sing one of her songs, "Blessed Assurance, Jesus is Mine."
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchased of God, born of His Spirit, washed in His blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior. Song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, perfect delight, visions of rapture now burst on my sight. Angels descending, ring from above, echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I am my Savior, and blessed, watching and waiting, looking above, filled with His goodness, lost in His love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long.
You may be seated.
Well, just again by way of announcement this morning, I want to remind you that the Wisdom Seekers will have coffee time here at the church, 10 o'clock. And that's all right, it's just a baby. Doesn't matter. We have lots of them around here. It's good. Sign of life, eh? Wisdom Seekers Coffee, Wednesday, 10 a.m. Wonderful stuff. Next Sunday evening, we're going to have another family reunion. Because we moved to two services, because we haven't probably seen a lot of each other in this past couple of years because of COVID, what we've decided to do is every once in a while on a Sunday evening, is we'll get a bunch of people together. We're going to put on something where people can come from both services, come together, we'll eat together, celebrate one another, and play some games afterwards as well. So next Sunday night, 4:30, we'll do the soup, the toppings, we'll get cookies and fruit for dessert, and bring a game to share. So next Sunday night, not this Sunday night, next Sunday night, 4:30, here at church. There also will be a spaghetti dinner, which will be in aid of Coldest Night of the Year. That's coming up November 9th. We've got a little poster right there on that notice board, a little poster at the back as well. And so it's November the 9th, a spaghetti dinner. It's at the Best Western. So over by the Irving Big Stop. Tickets are there. It's a fundraising event for Coldest Night of the Year. Of course, it's done through the Grind Drop-In Center here in town. Tickets are $10 for adults, $3 for kids. This is a good fundraising thing. Guys, this really is a good thing. This is a very simple thing that we can do. November the 9th, 6 p.m. at the Best Western for a spaghetti dinner, and eight of coldest night of the year. Next Sunday will be our Remembrance Sunday. Is that correct, Warrant? Yes, thank you. Because I got it the wrong way around last year. In the UK, we do it the Sunday after Remembrance Day. And then you told me, no, Rich, that's wrong. You're a master, Warrant. I'm sorry. That's right. Show off. Congratulations on that, man. That's a lot of work. But we will be having our Remembrance Sunday service next week. Do you see the size of that fella? This is his old pastor over here who's going to be speaking to us today. But yeah, I'll let you connect afterwards. But if you'd be so good, those who are serving in our Canadian Armed Forces and those who are veterans, if you would be able to wear your DEUs, that would be wonderful. Or if you've got any medals that you can wear as well, we'd love to be able to see that, recognize that, and to celebrate you next Sunday. One last thing. We're going to have a Christmas banquet again this year. Yes! So this is going to be great. Christmas banquet, it's going to come up Friday, December the 2nd. I mentioned that. I will continue to mention that. It's a little ways off. But we're going to have our Christmas banquet again this year. So shall we pray? This is Reformation Sunday. So this is the day that we celebrate when Luther nailed those 95 statements on the door, the church, Wittenberg, in Germany, and set off a movement that still has not stopped to this day. Let us pray together. Ephesians 2, 8 and 9 says, "For by grace you've been saved through faith. This is not your own doing, it is the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast." Lord Jesus, much of the Christian world recognizes today as Reformation Sunday. It's not a day for groveling and promising to reform ourselves. It's a day for remembering the sweetest, most necessary fruit that emerged from the Reformation. When Luther nailed his 95 theses to the door of Wittenberg Castle in October 31st, 1517, it was a glorious reminder that all of our sins have been nailed to your cross. Luther began a fresh chapter in the Back to the Gospel story, a story that preceded him and will continue until you, Lord Jesus, return. For we suffer from a gospel amnesia, an allergy to grace. We have truth dementia. We are faith forgetful, and along with a big dose of insufferable pride. The gospel declares our need to be greater than we want to admit, and the gospel declares that we are more loved than we can possibly imagine. We needed a new heart, not a fresh start. We needed to be grafted into the true vine, not merely turn over a new leaf. Only your saving grace and perfect righteousness are sufficient, not our tearful resolve, hard work, and sweaty grit. Lord Jesus, thank you for exhausting our guilt, taking our shame, and breaking our chains. And today, this morning, we reaffirm our hope is built on nothing less than your blood and righteousness, on your finished work on our behalf. Keep bringing us back to yourself and to the gospel of God's grace. All other sales saviors are snake oil salesmen. All other gospels are graceless liars. All other hopes are empty nothings. All other kings are hot air. All other riches are fool's gold. And all other peace is evaporating morning mist. Father, it's with these things in mind that we come before you to bring you those whom we love. We again do not want to grow weary in well-doing and continue to bring Ralph and Riley before you. And we pray for them that you would be their sustaining grace day by day as one, the old guy and the young guy go through cancer treatment. Lord, we thank you for the grace of modern medicine. But Father, too, we also ask for a touch from your hand in their lives. We ask for their healing. We pray for Gary and Josie. We pray for the Robichauds. And now we also pray for the Czech family as Thomas mourns the loss of his mom and his sons mourn the loss of their grandmother. This is the loss of another parent for Thomas within not even a handful of months. And so we pray that you would bring comfort to them at this time by your Holy Spirit. Father, this month, this whole month of October, we have supported and are supporting missions projects all over the world. We thank you for what has already been given. We pray that more would be given over and above our regular tithes and offerings. But Father, too, we do not want to forget our Jerusalem here in Pembroke, in the valley. And we pray for the grind and for their ministry as they bring the hope of the gospel to those who are on the edge of life. We pray, too, for the coldest night of year and the spaghetti supper coming up November 9. And we ask, O God, that there would be many who would come out to support, to raise cash for. And, Father, this becomes even more important as we enter into weeks and months and perhaps even a year or two of severe financial crunch where many will find it difficult to make ends meet. Father, may we be a part of helping make ends meet. And then, Father, for ourselves as a church here at Calvary, we have celebrated just this past year the release of Trailhead, our first church plant, into independence in Petawawa. And so we ask, Father, what is next? What is next for us? What are we to do? Where are we to go? What are we to say? Father, how are we to set ourselves up to continue to preach and spread the gospel in our very own Jerusalem? Lord, we ask for your guidance. We ask for your wisdom. Give us discernment, I pray. Thank you for these moments. Thank you again for the Lord Jesus, Father, because it's only by and through him that we can boldly approach your throne. Hear our prayers, I ask, in Jesus' name, and all God's people said, amen. Thank you.
Will you stand and sing with us? Blessed, we have a story to tell to the nations.
Story to tell to the nations that shall turn their hearts to the right. A story of truth and mercy, a story of peace and light, a story of peace and light. For the darkness shall turn to dawning, and the dawning to noonday bright. And Christ's great kingdom shall come to earth, the kingdom of love and light. Weave a song to be sung to the nations that shall lift their hearts to the Lord. A song that shall conquer evil and shatter the spear and sword. And shatter the spear and sword, for the darkness shall turn to dawning, and the dawning to noonday bright, and Christ's great kingdom shall come to earth, a kingdom of love and light. We've a message to give to the nations, that the Lord who reigns from above show us that God is love, and show us that God is love. For the darkness shall turn to dawning, and the dawning to noonday bright, and Christ's great kingdom shall come to earth, the kingdom of love and light. We've a Savior to show to the nations, who the path of sorrow has trod, that all of the world's great peoples might come to the truth of God, might come to the truth of God. For the darkness shall turn to dawning, and the dawning to noonday bright, and Christ's great kingdom shall come to earth, the kingdom of love and light.
You may be seated.
Good morning, everyone. All right, I have two quick announcements. Number one, our nursery program as of today on a test run is back open. So if you have any children who are ages 0 up to 2, there is a nursery program available for them. That will run throughout the entire service. So not just here when the kids are dismissed, it's for the entire service. Other than that, if you would like to take part in nursery, we would love to have you. We need some more hands in there holding babies and chasing little crawlers around. The other announcement is that tomorrow is technically our last day of our family missions project. So if you haven't done it yet, this is a great chance for you to pick up a bank, pick up one of our Advent calendars, and do it. We did it yesterday as a family. We did it all in one day. We kind of did a scavenger hunt running around. So there's still time to do that and bring your banks in next week if you didn't bring them already. All right, we're going to pray and then dismiss all the kids. Thank you, God, for who you are. Thank you that you love us. Thank you for your word and that it is true. Thank you for how it teaches us. So as we go to our class, we pray that you'll open our hearts, open our ears, help us to understand who you are and how you want to change our lives. We love you, God, in Jesus' name, amen. All right, kids, let's go.
It was a martyred, five missionaries were martyred on January the 8th, 1956. You can see their names, you can see their faces. And they were martyred in Ecuador as they were trying to bring the gospel to a tribe that was described by other tribes as the Alca Indians, meaning they were savages. And they went in there and made contact, and then they were murdered on the beach that you see there. You can show the next slides. So Nate Saint and Jim Elliott come to mind mostly for me because I was a young teenager at the time. And it made a very indelible impression on my life. I determined that I would become a missionary pilot like Nate Saint, and I would be in missions. I became a pilot, and I got involved in missions, but I wasn't a missionary pilot. But Jim Elliott is only 28 years old. Others were in their early 30s, and there was five widows left behind. But Jim Elliott, he is noted as saying, "He is no fool to give what he cannot keep, to gain what he cannot lose." The outcome of all that was that his widow went back into the jungle with their newborn baby that he had never seen, along with Nate Saint's sister, Rachel. And they work with the Indians who had actually murdered their husbands. And they came to Christ. It's really a story of super grace. The song I'd like to sing with you is the song that they sang the night before they were martyred. Be still, my soul. Would you sign and sing with me?
Be still, my soul.
Today. Well, my name is Dean O'Connor. I'm the director of Souls for Christ Ministries. We're a ministry that works on the streets in downtown Toronto, providing the gospel message as well as humanitarian aid to the homeless. We preach the gospel at major intersections weekly and bi-weekly and give out the gospel and see people come to Christ. In fact, 16 people have given their hearts to Jesus this year alone. We have two projects that we're raising interest and funds for, which we pray you'll get behind. Number one, New Testament Bibles, and number two, sleeping bags. It's very important that we get these essentials into the hands of those who need them most. You know that there's 8,000 homeless people who live on the streets? 74 of them have died on the streets since 2020. You know as well that there's a 12-year waiting list for housing, and 85% of those who live outside sleep rough. They don't have any coverings or sleeping bags at all. That's where we come in. We hit the streets, and so many have survived because we've gotten a sleeping bag or a blanket into the hands of the needy. You know, an elderly homeless man told me that the coat and the covering we gave him, the sleeping bag and blanket, saved him from death, from freezing to death on the streets. We hear so many stories like that. I saw a young Aboriginal lady about a year and a half ago. It was minus 10 and she was just wearing a t-shirt. I was able to quickly go over and take a coat out of my bag and give her a sleeping bag because she said she surely would have froze to death. Thank God for those who give to our projects and help provide essentials for those who are in need. Today we're appealing to you, Calvary, to ask you to come on board and support our Bible project and our sleeping bag project. And we thank you in advance for your giving. We thank you for giving previously and last year. And we pray you continue to support our projects in years to come. Thank you and God bless.
Good morning, church. Great to meet together here today. What a good project to support, eh? It's amazing. I just wrote a few more facts down here. So 7,000 individuals are in shelters currently in Toronto. And 740 families are housed in shelters or hotels. And 2,000 families are permanently housed in motels in Toronto. It's amazing how many poor people are around us and we might not even know. Or it's sometimes hard, even if you have a heart to give, to know who would need our help. But these people know, and so it's a good place to really be part of it and help. Also, the Kenchikum boxes, shoe boxes, they will be sent away after November 13th. So if you have boxes to fill them until 2 weeks from now and bring them. That would be great. Otherwise, they miss the flight up there. Now it is my pleasure to introduce Dr. Michael Pauke. He sits here to my right. I had to write down. He has such a long history of things he has achieved. So he's an ordained minister of the Associated Gospel Churches of Canada. He graduated from Briarcrest Bible College in Dallas, and also in Dallas from Dallas Seminary. He served as a church planter in Winnipeg. He also was senior pastor of Compass Point Bible Church in Burlington. Michael was involved in the Oral Leadership Program, which Richard also went through. He now serves as director of Briarcrest College and Seminary in Saskatchewan. Michael is married to Linda, and together they have a son and a daughter, and a grandson, Eli. Welcome to us. Thank you, morning. I want to pray for you.
Oh, sure.
Before you start. Father, we want to thank you for this morning. We want to thank you for bringing Michael here. It's a great privilege that you just teach us through so many ways. I ask you that you bless him, that you just speak through him to what we need. Father, you know our longings for teaching, for correction, for encouragement, and we look forward to this morning. Thank you for bringing him here and bless his ministry. In your son's name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Thank you, Paul, for your kind words. Indeed, it really is nice to be here with you today. I know guest speakers are supposed to say that, right? But it really is. I've been looking forward to it. Looking forward to seeing Paul and Denise a little bit later on. They were an absolute delight to work with in Burlington for a number of years, and Paul, as you know, embodies such a heart of a shepherd, doesn't he? And Denise has that acute ability to fearlessly challenge the narratives of the day, which are off target. And we so appreciated our time working and befriending and spending time with Paul and Denise. And there's a lot of kids between the two of you when you were sitting there in that row, Josh and Becky. It was great to see you guys here. Look forward to chatting with you afterwards. And it's good to finally meet Richard. I've had a number of conversations with him, email and over the phone as well. And, you know, your pastors, they love the Lord. They love truth. They love you and are committed to you and are committed to the lost. I want to commend you as a church for the emphasis you have on missions and on care for the needy and the power of the gospel. And this focus you have, I'm so impressed, and I want to bless you folks as a congregation for all that you're doing. And I want to encourage you, keep supporting your leaders. We're emerging out of a tremendously challenging time, and we'll see what the future holds, and we'll talk a little bit about that this morning. But we've got a great church, and it's an honor for me to be here with you today. I've served as a pastor, but I'm at Briarcrest College and Seminary now for the last almost 10 years. And let me just say this, and I've got to get the advertisement out of the way, but let me just hear me out for like 90 seconds. Briarcrest College and Seminary, we have a partnership of three Christ-centered, Bible-anchored, ministry-focused schools. We have a high school, a college, and a graduate school, a seminary. And our vision, really, our tagline is to provide an education that disciples. And so in our college programming, for example, we have a number of biblical theological programs, pastoral programs, but we also have 7 university degrees. And so we're a Bible college with university provincially authorized degrees. And then our graduate school is all modular. And all of our students come for a week at a time. And that allows them to continue on in their church ministry or their vocation, their business, whatever it may be. And they can extract themselves for a week at a time and come out and sharpen the saw, refine their skills so they can go back in and serve well. And so we're grateful for the stewardship that God has given us at Briarcrest for these last 87 years. Well, as I said, I'm commending you for your emphasis on missions. And the task of personal evangelism and global missions has never been easy. Like, we know that. And Don shared some stories of the Elliots and the Saint family and others, part of that tragic and yet glorious ending in that story of the Aka Indians. But as much as it's never been easy, it is extraordinarily challenging right here in Canada. In fact, we've probably never had such a challenging time. Other parts of the world, yes, but we've never found it as challenging, high-pressure context as we do today here in Canada. Because there was once a point when the church was really at the center of culture and society here in Canada. Honored, respected, esteemed, held in high regard. And then over the decades, we're pushed to the margins, right? And we're viewed as irrelevant, kind of out of touch, kind of on the sidelines of culture, inconsequential, but of no threat. But that's changed. We're no longer viewed as irrelevant and disconnected and inconsequential. In fact, today, the church and the message of Christ is largely viewed as a message of hostility and hate-mongering. And the message of Christ and the reputation of the church has taken a tremendous hit. Now, not all hold to that, but culture as a whole views us with hostility and derision. Suspect. We're seen as self-righteous religious extremists. Again, not by all, but by far too many. And so the task of personal evangelism and global mission is profoundly challenging because of the context, the cultural context, societal context we find ourselves living in today. It'd be no exaggeration to say that one of the most offensive things you could say, one of the most politically insensitive things you could say is to share your faith and to somehow challenge somebody's personal autonomy, to challenge their truth, and to suggest that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, and that no one comes to God but through him because of his work on the cross, and that we have to believe, that's going to be met by all kinds of pushback and opposition. This is the cultural context we're in today. And so this morning, when we think of the task of personal evangelism and global mission, I thought I'd turn our attention to a story, a remarkable story of resilience and fortitude and stamina and strength. It's an Old Testament story. Your pastor read from Zephaniah this morning. I want to take you to the book of Jeremiah. So turn to Jeremiah, and as you're turning, let me put this into a little bit of context here. Jeremiah's ministry took place over about 5 decades. And he enters the scene, and you can read about his call to ministry in utero. There in the 13th year of the king Josiah, who was a good king there in Judah, the southern tribes. And into that context, Josiah was bringing about some reformation. And you need to know the larger context, because just prior to Josiah coming on the scene, Judah had suffered under 55 years of leadership of King Manasseh. He was corrupt, he was evil, he was an idolater, and he enabled and facilitated and promoted all kinds of idolatrous worship. In fact, if you look at the northern tribes, they had nothing but bad kings, and then in the southern tribes, there were a few good kings, but a number of bad kings as well. Josiah comes on the scene, finds the scriptures, finds the law, and starts to experience and initiate an internal revival. And so there's a lot of good that Josiah accomplishes, but alas, he dies rather prematurely. Job isn't completed, and then the subsequent kings that follow him once again enable Israel to once again follow the Baals and the Asherahs and drift from the Lord their God. Now, Jeremiah is ministering to these days, calling people to the worship of Yahweh, calling people to worship the one true God. And Jeremiah is also aware of what's going on in the world politically. You see, in the north, the northern tribes, Israel, they had fallen to the Assyrians. The Assyrians had been a threat, but they were in decline. They were in a diminishing state. Egypt, which had one time been strong, had weakened, but now was growing strong again. But there was a larger force, a new bully in the block, Babylon. And Jeremiah keeps calling people to return to the one true God, to repentance and to singularity of focus, trust, and worship. Of course, Jeremiah would finally witness Babylon coming under the leadership of King Nebuchadnezzar. He would surround Jerusalem, lay it under siege, and after a lengthy siege and thousands of deaths, starvation, cruel treatment, Jerusalem would fall. And in the subsequent years, 40 to 50,000 Jews were taken to Babylon in exile. Many young, like Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and others. Many to stay in exile, others to be sent back to give leadership. But there in Babylon, they would be immersed in Babylonian culture, in Babylonian education. And it's fascinating to read about what went on as you work through the book of Daniel. Jeremiah sees all this. And Jeremiah is often called the weeping prophet because of what he experienced. No growth charts, no record attendance, no book signing, no accolades, no retirement party. The weeping prophet. That was what his ministry tenure was characterized by. And so we come to Jeremiah chapter 11, but before we do, I just want to read to you one segment from the Psalms. Stay in Jeremiah, but scholars aren't exactly sure who wrote Psalm 137, but many think it was Jeremiah. where he said, by the waters of Babylon, there we sat down and wept when we remembered Zion. All these people in exile in Babylon, they couldn't help but think of those good days back in Judah. On the willows there, we hung up our lyres, for there our captors required of us songs, and our tormentors mirth, saying, sing us one of those songs of Zion. How shall we sing the Lord's song in a foreign land? How shall we sing? How can we celebrate here in exile and in these horrendous conditions? That was Jeremiah's life. So, Jeremiah 11. Jeremiah becomes aware that there's a plot to take his life. Curiously enough, not by the Assyrians, not by Egypt, not by the Babylonians, but by his own kinsmen. And Jeremiah is just overwhelmed with discouragement, and he's frustrated, he's angry, he's perplexed, he's confused, and he's wrestling with God. And in chapter 12, the very next chapter, he wrestles with God. So follow with me. In Jeremiah chapter 12, verse 1. Righteous are you, O Lord, when I complain to you. Yet I would plead my case before you. And so what he's saying is, God, I know you're just. I know you're righteous. I know you're holy. But I'm struggling. And I'm asking you to hear me out. Why does the way of the wicked prosper? Why do all who are treacherous thrive? You plant them, and they take root. They grow and produce fruit, and you're near in their mouth and far from their heart, especially his own people. Oh, they talked about Yahweh. They talked about the Lord, but he was not in their hearts, and their heart was not in him. But you, O Lord, you know me. You see me. You test my heart toward you. Pull them out like sheep for the slaughter and set them apart for the day of slaughter. How long will the land mourn and the grass of every field wither? For the evil of those who dwell in it and the beasts and the birds that are swept away because they said, he will not see our latter end. So here, struggling. He was struggling, and these are often called the imprecatory appeals of the Old Testament. And there are many psalms like this, these imprecatory psalms, which are basically humans calling on justice from God. David found himself in this kind of situation frequently. And he calls on God to bring him justice, to bring about justice, to free him, to deliver him, to protect him, to ensure that justice will one day be realized. And here, Jeremiah is in that similar kind of vein, calling out to God because he's confused, he's perplexed, and he's angry. Now, sometimes in the Psalms, we see God giving a response that reminds David or the other psalmists who reference these complaints, these frustrations with God. And sometimes you see God appealing to the justice that will one day be realized. And this is so human. It's so human to ask God why. I mean, you ask God why. I ask God why. We can't help. It's not the best question. The better question is, what can we learn from it? But we do ask why. And so we might ask, why Ukraine? Why is this going on? Why is there elder abuse? Why is modern day slavery, human trafficking, continue to be such a lucrative and thriving enterprise? Why 40 years of abortion? Why made? I mean, it's a euphemism for something, oh, so mild, suicide. And since 2016, medical assistance in dying has seen some 31,000 suicides, medically assisted deaths, which originally were intended to address those who were literally dying because of advanced illnesses, which, of course, has its own issues. But now it addresses those that are struggling with mental health issues, disabilities, and now their conversations about euthanizing children. Why? And maybe you've been victimized, maybe you've been the recipient of pure raw evil. Or maybe you've been sued, or maybe you've been maligned at work, or something for which you're completely undeserving, but things have gone sideways. And you ask, why? And here Jeremiah is struggling with the whys of life like we all do. And again, as I said, while in some occasions in the Psalms an answer is given, the response that God gives to Jeremiah is a fascinating one. I want you to look at verse 5. Because he doesn't give him an answer, he asks him a question. Verse 5. Jeremiah, if you have raced with men on foot, and they have wearied you, how will you compete with horses? And if in a safe land you are so trusting, what will you do in the thicket of the Jordan? God gives Jeremiah two scenarios, two pictures, a foot race and a leisurely walk in a meadow. And he says, Jeremiah, if in a foot race you become fatigued and exhausted running against other humans, how will you run against horses? And if in a safe country, in a beautiful meadow with a well-worn path, you become fatigued and you stumble, how will you handle the thicket of the Jordan, this dense jungle, which frequently with heavy rains would move to flood levels, which was the housing of all kinds of predators, the Asiatic lion and others who made this particular region a very dangerous area. How, if you stumble in the safe country, what are you going to do in the thicket of the Jordan? In other words, Jeremiah, if you're struggling today, what are you going to do when it gets really tough? And it would, as Nebuchadnezzar and his Babylonian horde surrounded Jerusalem. Perplexing. Tough reading. Hard to process. And how are we to respond when we're given that kind of a challenge, when we're asked that penetrating a question? But as we keep reading in Jeremiah, the how emerges. So if you keep reading Jeremiah, you'll find that Jeremiah's book isn't written really in logical, chronological fashion. It's quite cyclical. But nonetheless, when we come to chapter 17, we find an answer, a solution. How are we going to respond? How are we going to live this way in the face of these daunting odds of running against horses and navigating the thickets of the Jordan? And so in chapter 17, God is again speaking to Jeremiah, and Jeremiah is identifying the sins of Judah, the southern tribes. And in verse 5, he says this, "Thus says the Lord, cursed," cursed, strong language, "cursed is the man who trusts in man and makes flesh his strength, whose heart turns away from the Lord." In other words, the person who places their confidence, their dependence, their absolute trust in flesh and blood, that person is cursed. Now, this needs some clarification. Never in the scriptures are we invited to passivity. There's always human responsibility. There's always human engagement. There's always work. But this is what God is getting at here. He's flying in the face of that intuitive approach to life, which says, if it's going to be, it's up to me. And you and I have this built-in sense that we're the ones, we're the gods of our own destiny, and we will make things happen. Now, work hard. Initiate. Put effort into your day, into all that you do. But our trust, our confidence for absolute success, the real lifeline, it's always and only God. And here we're told, cursed is a man who places his trust in man. And then he says this, he's like a shrub in the desert and shall not see any good come, He shall dwell in the parched places of the wilderness in an uninhabited salt land. And the image I have, and this image I see all the time in Saskatchewan, I should say all the time, but frequently, of the Russian thistle, the tumbleweed, especially when it's dry and arid, these weeds that just blow across the highway, lifeless, empty, fruitless. That's what this person is like who trusts in man, who places all their confidence. I've worked hard. I deserve what I have, and I'm going to be the author of my own destiny. And Jeremiah says, no, that's not the way to think and live. So by way of contrast, he then says this in verse 7. Blessed is the man. Confident is the man. Happy is the man. Thankful is the man who trusts in the Lord, whose trust is the Lord. The object of our confidence, the object of our trust, our ultimate dependence, we work, we initiate, we have human responsibility. But the object of our ultimate dependence is always God. He is the object of our trust. The object of our trust, the object of our prayers is always God. It's not our own faith. Oh, I just need more faith. It's not in some sort of formula. It's always God. And then he describes how this happens. And you might remember these words from a different psalm. He says in verse 8, he is like a tree planted by water that sends out its roots by the stream. It does not fear when heat comes, for its leaves remain green and is not anxious in the year of the drought. For it does not cease to bear fruit. And here he gives us the spiritual truth. The way we're going to have the resilience and the fortitude and the strength and the grit to be strong in the face of daunting odds is by being like this strong tree that's planted by living water. Of course, it's Psalm 1. You can read that on your own later on. And the life that being plugged into that life source and the strength and the resilience and the fortitude that that gives us. And so this is what Jeremiah is driving home, that this kind of grit in life, this kind of determination to remain faithful and true in our walk with God and in our calling and in our mission, it's because of our relationship with God. And this produces a mission grit. Cursed is the man who places his trust in flesh and blood. Psalm 20, verse 5 says, some trust in chariots, some trust in horses, but we trust in the name of the Lord. And Jeremiah and all the great leaders and prophets and men and women of God of the Old Testament and the New Testament, what kept them and sustained them with a mission grit was this reliance and dependence and anchoring in their relationship with God. He was the object of their trust. And so this morning for a few minutes, I want us to reflect a little bit on some domains of mission grit. How will we remain strong? How can we remain resilient? How can we have this kind of fortitude? And let's think for a moment about mission grit in our convictions, in our beliefs, in our values, our relentless commitment to the authority of God's word, our clarity of commitment to the identity of Jesus and his work on the cross, the need for the new birth, and of course, the hope of transformation and the wonder of change. All these things happen because of our continued engagement with truth, whereby we give the Holy Spirit that opportunity to take truth, living truth, and have it transform our lives. I work at an educational institution. Our college programs are all 4-year degrees. But the most important thing I want our students to leave with is a fundamental commitment to reading God's word, to hiding God's word in their heart, and to living by it. I share this story often with our students. When Paul and Denise are here later, they'll say, oh, I heard that. But I came to Christ through the Gideon New Testament. I was 11, going on 12. My parents were going through a very messy, destructive divorce. And I dug out that little Gideon New Testament, give me in grade 5. Some of you know that experience, right? And in the front, there's a story about a man named John Nicholson who made a promise to his mother to read his Bible every day. And I read that as a kid, and I'm thinking, I could do that. And I did. And every day, I spent time, not for preparing for a chapel or a talk or a lesson or a class, but for my own soul to stay plugged in, to be a resilient tree with grit that's plugged into the life source of the living river. Time in God's word. Friends, if you and I are going to have the grit, the mission grit, to survive the days that we find ourselves living in, if we're going to have the grit in our convictions, we need to be tending to our spirit and to be feeding our souls. And I know you hear this. I'm sure you hear this from your pastors. But that's such a non-negotiable life source. I weary of hearing the drift and the deconstructing and the abandoning of so many. In fact, we know this, and this gives me inspiration in our setting as an educational institution. We know that 2/3 of our emerging adults will leave the church. 2/3. When they finish high school and into the next stage of life, 2/3 will leave the church, and half of that number will completely abandon their faith. And that's been going on by studies. We know this has been going on for at least the last 12, 13 years. We have got to stop that. We've got to be in the Word, giving resolve to our convictions and to our beliefs. Secondly, we need mission grit in our courage in the face of absolutely frightening obstacles. And they are frightening. And fear has this incredible power to paralyze, to imprison, to cause us to withdraw and hold back and ghettoize. And whether it's fear of external forces, our woke culture, whether it's society's values, or whether it's external pressures of work or government, or whether it's internal pressures that we feel from family and friends, or whether it's fear of failure, or whether it's fear of being exposed and found, well, I'm not as resilient and strong as godly as I'd like to be, and I don't want them to. And all these fears cause us just to withdraw and hold back. And the evil one wins the day when we capitulate to fear. And we need mission grit. We need that kind of resilience and that kind of strength that Jeremiah speaks of. Not only in our convictions, but also in our courage. And friends, courage doesn't mean you don't have any fear. But courage means you have a greater faith than your fears have to incapacitate you. It's just greater, and you press forward. And this is an old story in my experience, but it was such a defining experience in my life. Because I come from a broken home. I trusted Christ, but I had become very intimidated, very insecure, very, very fearful. And so we moved from the country to Toronto, the big city. I was afraid of this new high school, afraid of everything. And the Lord gets a hold of my heart, and I end up being discipled by a mission agency, by a missionary who did open-air meetings in downtown Toronto. Now, I'm not advocating necessarily for open-air meetings in downtown Toronto now, but he would take us down, all of us from the youth group, to Yonge and Gould, just outside of Sam the Record Man. That doesn't exist anymore either, I don't expect, but some of you know what that was. And we'd set up a stage, and in minutes, you'd have 70, 80, 90 people listening. And one occasion says, Pawelki, you're going to speak next week. And I thought, there's not a chance I'm going to speak next week. But when we face those kinds of fears, and we see God work, and we're part of stepping out in faith, even with those fears, and we see God work, it catapults us forward in our faith. And I continue to face fears, as do you. And we have to step into those fears with courage and with mission grit. Mission grit, it's got to be something that feeds our convictions. It's got to be something that feeds our courage. And mission grit has got to be something that also shapes and feeds our commitments in spite of the overwhelming pressure to quit. Why do you think the scriptures, particularly the New Testament, although the Old Testament packages this in a sense of be strong and courageous, but in the New Testament frequently talks about enduring, persevering. Why? Because the desire and the urge to quit visits every one of us. To quit our marriage, to quit our church, to quit being salt and light, and to just give up and to give in. And when we're plugged into the life source, like a resilient tree with fortitude and strength and grit, that will provide the life source as we place our trust there to be true and faithful and resilient to our commitments, to our commitment to the Lord, and to the stewardship of the mission that he has given to us, to be salt and light, the stewardship of the Great Commission, which I see you engaged in as a church. Let me project for a minute. And I say this carefully because this particular message is a little bit one that's of a more challenging nature. But what do you think tomorrow holds? What do you think the future holds for us here in Canada, here in Pembroke? I know you think about it. We all do. What does tomorrow hold? See, so many of us have grown long accustomed to seasons of more, better, cleaner, more advanced, increased salary, nicer car, slightly larger home, and everything keeps moving up and to the right. And this is what we quite have become accustomed to and what we quite like and what we quite want. And that's possible, that we might continue to be bigger, better, faster, cleaner, happier. All those things, they could happen. But we also are well aware that we're in a season where a $1.3 trillion national debt is unfathomable. Like, I don't get it. A debt that our children and children's children will have to deal with. We're in a season where we're either in or in the precipice of recession. The cultural pressures on us are just absolutely humanly unbearable, and that's putting pressure on us to withdraw. When we think of our culture of death, as we talk about abortion and medical assistance in dying, and just our decreasing value of the dignity of human life, the confusion in our gender identity, what do you think tomorrow holds? Maybe we'll get on our knees, and maybe we'll seek the Lord for revival, and there may be once again an upturn that impacts culture. Or maybe we're going to be facing some very challenging, difficult times. I'm not so much wanting to have any desire to be on the side of negativity, because we have the hope of the gospel. We have a stewardship and a responsibility. But the days ahead, we might have good days, but we also might have extraordinarily challenging days. And what does the Lord say to us? He tells us with great clarity. He says, if you have raced with men on foot, and they have wearied you, how will you compete with horses? And if it's in a safe country where you're so trusting, how will you do in the thicket of the Jordan? We need to do that with grit, with mission grit, and that will only come from a deeply tended to, intimate, abiding relationship of trust with our God. Let's pray. Father and our God, we confess that we are so unable to project what the future holds. But whatever the future holds, we know we have to be strong. We have to be resilient. We have to have grit, mission grit. And so, Father, I pray for every person here this morning that you'd stir our hearts to tend to our relationship with you. And if there are people here who are perhaps visiting or perhaps new to Calvary, I pray that you'd stir in their hearts to give thought to your work in their world and in their life and your draw of them into a relationship with you. But Father, for all of us, grant that we wouldn't be caught up in the elixir of the temporary things of this world. Help us to tend to our relationship with you. Give us the discipline to be in your word, that it might wash away the cultural lies that we hear every day and replace it with truth, with your comfort, with your encouragement, with your guidance, with your ways. And then, Father, would you give us courage? Every one of us have opportunities where we can step out in faith, some sort of demonstration of courage, to speak a word, to do an act of kindness, to somehow draw a line and say, not today. God, give us that courage because we're plugged into your life source. And then, Father, when those temptations become extraordinarily strong to quit, grant us the resilience and the endurance by your Spirit to persevere. Father, I want to pray a blessing upon this church, upon its leaders, upon everyone here, that you take and use the testimony of this church as salt and light here in Pembroke and beyond. And so this I pray in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Been given a lot to think about, eh? Mike, thank you for the challenge this morning to us all, to my heart as well. We've been given a lot to think about. Be in the Word. Pray to Jesus. Be in community. It's really as simple as that, eh? Will you please stand with me if you're able as I read the Great Commission over us on our last Mission Sunday in October 2022. And Jesus came and said to them, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always to the end of the age." And all God's people said, amen. You are dismissed. Go in peace.